Plastic is firmly established in our daily lives, but it's only existed for about a century or so. As we consider the long-term harms of rapidly accruing pollution, it begs the question, would it be so bad to finally break up with plastics? And is it even possible at this point? It's not like we don't have better options all around us. We can convert starches, fungi, seaweed, heck, even shrimp tails into materials that have the potential to offer more benefits and less baggage. So let's review five of the most interesting advances I've come across, including that shrimpy stuff. But are any of these plastic alternatives actually viable? Or are we just literally grasping at straws? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. This video is brought to you by Lark, but more on that later. In a previous video, I discussed how we've been misled into thinking that plastic recycling, well, happens at all, much less works smoothly when we do bother. But I think the scale of the problem is best summed up by an off-site statistic. By 2015, we had only recycled about 9% of plastics ever made. We already know plastic recycling is a farce, and we're becoming increasingly aware of how our own bodies are reflecting the pervasiveness of plastic pollution. So if we want to reduce the dependence on plastics, where do we start? The majority of plastics that we use are dedicated to packaging. Just think of all the plastic involved in a single grocery store run. Clamshell cases from the bakery, film that lets you peek at your pasta, stretchy bags of rice, and of course, bottles. We can do better than that though, with materials that can be composted right at home. I've talked about quite a few alternatives that avoid these problems before, so let's do a roll call and find out how they're doing now. If you're a 3D printing enthusiast, you're probably already familiar with polylactic acid, or PLA. PLA falls under the category of a bioplastic. It's typically made of carbs like potatoes and corn, and companies have been incorporating it into their packaging arsenals as far back as the early 2000s. PLA is technically both recyclable and compostable, but it suffers from the same problems as other plastics. There isn't much effective infrastructure for either process. Other plastics like HDPE and PET are more valuable, so recyclers tend to prioritize those. Now, for this video, I want to focus on alternatives that can easily break down in, like, let's say, your garden, which avoids the labor involved in retrieving and preparing plastics for industrial composting. So why am I bringing up PLA? Well, because you can compost PLA at home if the product in question contains an enzyme that allows it to easily break down later. And that's exactly what French company Carbiolase, which is a subsidiary of Carbios, specializes in. It developed Carbios Active, an enzyme that once incorporated during manufacturing, allows for PLA plastics to biodegrade within 8 weeks, at room temperature. Now, typically composting PLA requires high and constant temperatures at an industrial scale. Think heat as high as 58 degrees Celsius or 136 degrees Fahrenheit. Last year, we left off with Carbiolase's 2021 announcement that it had obtained its second OK Compost Home certification for rigid PLA plastic produced with its enzyme. Now, this followed its first certification for thin PLA films in 2020. And since then, the US Food and Drug Administration added Carbios Active to its inventory of effective food contact substances earlier this year. What this means is that US-based industries can now use PLA that incorporates Carbiolase's enzyme for food packaging. That's a big deal for popularizing compostable PLA. However, it's worth keeping in mind that bio-based plastics only represented about 1.5% of plastic production in 2021, and bio-based doesn't necessarily mean compostable. So what about an alternative material that's a little more established? Maybe something with deeper roots? Well, for those of you who have been watching for a while, you might remember when I talked about fungi materials way back in 2021. Yes, fungi.
I'm a fun guy.
The organisms that are neither plant, nor animal, nor guy. More specifically, companies like Egovative are branching out applications for mycelium, the delicate networks of roots that grow beneath fungi. Headquartered in New York State, Egovative has been experimenting with multiple mushroom ventures since 2007. And one of the most fascinating is its mycelium composite packaging called Mycocomposite. Now, I've got a sample of what that looks like right here. I've actually had this on my shelf back there for the past like 10 months or so. This mixture of mycelium and agricultural waste can supplant the polystyrene foam that's notoriously ubiquitous inside cardboard boxes delivered to your door. Companies have used this stuff to ship everything from cosmetics and candles to furniture. I mean, I've actually bought some furniture for my new house that came with this stuff. In September of 2023, Egovative opened up its patent for Mycocomposite under the European Open Patent Program, granting all European companies access to its materials for the development of their own products. That said, there is one common application that Mycocomposite isn't appropriate for: food. So how else can we take a bite out of plastic packaging? Well, before getting into the next plastic advance, there's something else that I'd recommend giving a try, and that's challenging yourself to get as much one-time use plastic out of your life as you can. I'm still trying to do better about that myself, and one of the best ways you can do that is not using single-use plastic water bottles. Today's sponsor, Lark, can help you with that. Now, their newest is the Lark Bottle PureViz 2, which has some really cool tech inside it to not only filter the water, but to purify it. It uses UVC LED technology to automatically purify the water every 2 hours. The filtration removes things like PFAS and chlorine, so you can get great tasting water. My favorite part of this is the bottle cleans itself, so lazy people rejoice. I'm definitely in that camp. And if you're a tech geek like me, you'll love the new Lark mobile app that tracks how much water you're drinking and gives you a gentle reminder that it's time to drink more. I know I don't drink enough during the day, so it's a great reminder. If you'd like to challenge yourself to cut out one-time use plastic in your life and get fresh tasting pure water on the go, use the link in the description below to order yourself a Lark Bottle PureViz 2. I'm really loving mine. Thanks again to Lark and to all of you for supporting the channel. Now back to the question, how else can we take a bite out of plastic packaging? I mentioned earlier that plant-based bioplastics, like the kind made out of food crops, can be problematic. But what about other types of plants? Well, a couple years ago, I talked about companies that are transforming seaweed into product packaging. You might remember that at the 2019 London Marathon event, organizers were able to significantly cut down on the number of plastic drink bottles tossed out that day by replacing a portion of them with these fantastical-looking seaweed pouches. Developed by London-based company Knotpla, these bubbles can biodegrade within 6 weeks. Or if you don't want to wait that long, you can literally just eat them. Knotpla's seaweed-derived products expand beyond comestible containers too, including takeout boxes, cutlery, and paper. And since we first met Knotpla, it's reached some pretty impressive milestones. In 2021, the European Union codified its Single-Use Plastics, or SUP, directive into law, requiring all 27 of its member states to enforce a ban on specific plastic items. Each state, however, upholds its own interpretations of the ban, and of course, there are legal loopholes. For example, Knotpla is unafraid to point out that some paper and cardboard food boxes that competitors advertise as plastic-free still contain microplastics in their linings. However, Knotpla stands out because its boxes are all seaweed, no petrochemical, with no skimping on any anti-moisture coating. In fact, the Netherlands, which strictly enforces the SUP directive, examined thousands of materials to ensure that they upheld their polymer promises. Of all of them, Knotpla was the first and only material to emerge as fully compliant with the EU's definition of plastic-free. Then there's movement in the US, like with Lollyware, headquartered on both the East and West Coasts, and California company Sway. Lollyware has been experimenting with seaweed straws and flatware, and when we last saw Sway, it was putting its winnings from the 2020 Beyond the Bag Challenge towards development of its signature kelp bags. Earlier this year, Sway announced the release of a new material, a thermoplastic seaweed resin, or TPC, pun after my own heart. The name might sound a bit drunk, but it's meant to address a sobering problem: industry reliance upon plastics like polyethylene for single-use packaging. According to Sway, flexible plastics in bags and wrappers make up about 30% of these applications. That's where TPC can cut right in, no new infrastructure required. The company claims this will enable the production of seaweed films and polybags at scale. So here's hoping that we see more seaweed and that it will hold its sway. Say that 5 times fast. We're gonna get to another kind of undersea material in a minute, but first, now that we've covered seaweed, it's time for a different kind of weed. And by that, I mean hemp. But hold on, put down that lighter. Hemp is not the popular plant that smoked. It's a derivative of cannabis that doesn't contain as much THC. Despite the fact that it's not psychoactive, its association with drugs has led to a turbulent legal history here in the States. However, in 2018, the US government passed a federal farm bill legalizing hemp production. That has since paved the way for hemp's adoption as a building material in the form of a composite known as hempcrete. So why hemp? First of all, building and construction is the second largest application of plastics across the globe. They're used everywhere from windows to the walls. A significant chunk of the plastics used in construction, though, comes in the form of insulation. Between all the varieties of fiberglass and foam, it's no wonder. And fun fact, despite common parlance, styrofoam has never been used for dining or drinking. It's probably hiding in your home, school, or workplace instead. Hempcrete can work as a non-toxic, compostable alternative to plastic-derived insulation. It also offers distinct advantages as a building material in general. It's fire-resistant, and because of the high pH of its lime-based binder, it also wards off pests and mold. As a crop, hemp sequesters carbon. In fact, it might be even better at absorbing CO2 than trees. That's at least according to Darshal Shah, the senior researcher at the Center for Natural Material Innovation at the University of Cambridge in England. Now, one of the main limitations of hempcrete, however, is it's not load-bearing the way concrete is. Load-bearing components support other sections of buildings on top of their own weight. Basically, you can build interior walls with hempcrete outright, and you can fill in exterior walls with it as a form of insulation, but you can't use it to construct the frame of a house. It can only support its own weight. Unless, of course, you're using another form of hemp composite, specifically the kind developed by a research team led by Professor Mark McGuire at the University of Nebraska-Lincoln's College of Engineering. This form of hemp block is a lighter alternative to Portland cement, but it still meets load-bearing standards for strength, water absorption, and weight. It currently is undergoing testing. That said, it was true in 2022, and it's still true now. The States has a lot of catching up to do in the hemp scene. As McGuire says, hemp remains the most expensive component in hempcrete production because there's simply not enough being grown. That means for now, hemp blocks are about 3 times as costly as traditional concrete ones. But you know what's really cheap? Literal garbage. In this case, the shells of shrimp. Just like their insect cousins, crustacean exoskeletons contain chitin, a form of biopolymer. And through the magic of chemistry, you can convert chitin into chitosan. And what makes chitosan worth dumpster diving for? Well, it's kind of like scoring an expensive piece of vintage leather while thrifting. That's because New York-based startup TomTex has figured out a way to mold shrimp waste-derived chitosan into a new type of leather. It looks just as glam, can be fully biodegradable, and best of all, contains no plastics. Because you see, textiles are another major application of plastics. When it comes to vegan leather in particular, it's either straight up plastic, like in the case of polyurethane and polyvinyl chloride, or it's just a plant-based material bound with and covered in plastic. Green in color maybe, but not in practice. If avoiding materials made from any part of an animal is your priority though, TomTex also produces leather made from chitosan harvested from mushrooms, which performs identically to its seafood sister. In November 2023, the company announced that it was kicking off full-scale production after the successful creation of 100 linear feet of material. With any hope, TomTex's concoction will be able to adapt to already existing infrastructure intended for plastics like polyurethane or polyvinyl alcohol. So who's hungry for a shrimp cocktail? It's clear that even though plastic alternatives are only now starting to gain momentum, we have the creativity and the know-how to think bigger than petrochemicals. It might mean embracing source materials that we've previously held our noses at, like hemp or waste, but it beats the status quo. After all, it wasn't too long ago that consumers were only getting used to plastic proliferation in the first place. So what's stopping us from adapting again? But what do you think? Have you used any of these alternatives or something similar? Which ones are you most curious about? Jump in the comments and let me know, and be sure to listen to my follow-up podcast, Still to be Determined. We'll keep this conversation going. Also, I'm going to be at the Everything Electric Canada show in Vancouver from September 6th to the 8th. It's a great show all about home energy and electric vehicles, and I'll be hosting some of the panels. If you're interested in getting tickets, I'll have a link in the description, and if you do go, be sure to say hi. Thanks as always to my patrons for your continued support, and I'll see you in the next one.